Everybody, welcome to episode 3 of the King and I podcast presented by our friends at Monster Energy. Here with Jeremy McGrath at his home in Encinitas. This is the first time I've ever been here, dude. And I was telling you before, I remember when you just bought your house in Canyon Lake.
Yeah.
And I was just blown away. We were in our 20s and it was 26 years ago, 25 years ago.
Yeah, that was like 94.
I had my daughter Samantha with me and she was barely walking. She was one. And come check out my house.
So she was born in like 93 or 4?
Yeah. And so we're walking around and I was just like, oh my God. Remember there's that separate little house down by the lake?
Yeah, that was our bar kind of man cave area that we, that was a cool room.
Well, I remember just going, dude, this is crazy. You're insane. And you're like, I haven't even gone off. When I go off, you'll see. And so this is going off.
Well, I mean, you know, it was weird because the reason I'm in Encinitas is not only because of my wife. When we met, she was going to San Diego State, mm-hmm. and she lived with me in Canyon Lake for a while, but that drive was a little rough, right? It was a long drive. But the reason I'm here is because I thought when I was done racing, I'd be working at No Fear with Sirwall.
No way, really?
Yeah, that's the reason I came down here. Obviously, when I did Supercross only contract, I thought, wow, it doesn't really make sense to be up here in this heat all the time because mm-hmm. it's hot. And I know home is home, right? But still, I was like, you know what? I'm going to get close to the beach. When I'm done racing, we have our No Fear MX company. We're going to be working there. Mm-hmm. The commute's just 15 minutes from here. I'm like, I just planned on being an office guy.
Yeah.
And things,
it's pretty funny.
Things are crazy how they work out. And obviously that didn't happen, but
to think that you were thinking you're going to have to like work or do an office job or something, or were you being humble about that?
Well, I mean, look, dude, I hope for the best, but I plan for the worst.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's not a good, not in my nature. It's not very good to just think that stuff's going to happen the right way. You know, of course I like working. I'm not afraid to work. I like to be in the ditch with everyone. It's mm-hmm. not like I'm, not make cut out for that.
Oh, we've seen that at
the shop. I'm not cut out for that. I'm not cut out for sitting up on a pedestal. I want to be normal and in the ditch with everybody else. And so, of course, I thought I was going to be working. And it's a shame it didn't work out the way we kind of had this big grand plan. But at the end of the day, life is weird, mm-hmm. It takes twists and turns all the way. And I'm happy to be down here in Encinitas. I love the beach. And we have
beautiful. So we're in your garage.
Yeah,
how many square feet is this garage? It's bigger than my house.
I don't know the square footage, but it's like 40 deep by 60, 40 by 60. So it's pretty big. So half of it is sort of this room we're in, and downstairs is like a gym and a bathroom and stuff. And then kind of outside is where the, moto stuff is or whatever. Mm-hmm.
And then the famous hallway right here.
It's funny, the hallway, so when we built this place in 99, we were first in the neighborhood. It was a planned neighborhood, so we got to pick the house plan that we wanted. And it was awesome because when I came here, I drove around the neighborhood and picked the lot I wanted and everything. So I was kind of first up here, which was pretty awesome. But we did a major remodel in like 2008, right when the shit hit the fan. Uh-huh. And part of the reason of the remodel was to display, sort of have a trophy room.
Yeah.
I'm not kind of one of those guys that would have my stuff in the house, really. Mm-hmm. But in order to have a cool display area, we thought, well, hey, let's just connect the garage to the house,
Mm-hmm. Oh, so that's...
And so that was not connected until, 10, whatever, 08. So a while ago, 12 years ago, 14 years ago.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, so it's worked out well because it's really, a trip down memory lane, just walking down the hallway is kind of fun.
Okay, so this place in Encinitas, huge spread. Like, what's the square footage on that?
We're at 2 acres here, which is a lot of work, by the way. And every house in the neighborhood here is like 2 acres. Uh-huh. And when we originally bought it, it was 6,000 feet was the house, square feet. But we've added on and extended and stuff, so it's a little bigger. But it's a lot, Mm-hmm. It's cool with our kids at the age they are. We have a great place for them to come play, and their friends can come over, and they can even be over here if they don't want to be over there with us.
Yeah.
So it's worked out well, but you know, it's weird that when you're young, you're like, you want to accumulate, right? You're like, oh, I'm going to get a big house. I'm going to get a big garage. I'm going to get more stuff, more shit. And just, you want to clutter your life in as you, because you think it's just such a status thing, you know? But I swear, man, now that I'm older, I just can't wait till I can downsize.
Really?
Yeah, honestly. I love my place and I love the view. And, you know, it's weird. Growing up in Menifee off the highway, which a lot of you guys know the track right off the highway, the 215 right there by the hospital now. All the moto kids, they know it. You know, that house had a view of Idlewild and Big Bear and all that stuff. And my track, the house was kind of up. So I always was like, man, I didn't know that I missed having a view like that growing up until I moved to Canyon Lake.
Yeah.
And you're kind of stuck in a hole in Canyon Lake. And yeah, we had a lake view and stuff, which was cool. But moving back here on the hill, it's just like to have this view again was something I really missed and something I want to have for the rest of my life is a view. I can have a peanut shell of a house. I don't care about that. Nice garage would be good.
Yeah.
But, you know, the day when we can downsize, and if we do, you know, if Kim lets me downsize, we'll certainly have a view somewhere, just be a lot smaller.
So 6,000 square foot house, and it's bigger than that now. Do you guys like call each other on your cell phones? Like, hey, where's Bergen?
Sometimes we actually do. We, I'll be in the gym and Kim will be over at the house or whatever, vice versa. And so, yeah, it's, sometimes it's easier. It would be cool to have an intercom, but those things are so 80s.
Yeah, right?
It would be sweet, though. Push a button, be like a CB radio system.
Or you could look
house.
On your phone and have the Find My Friends.
Oh, remember the old phones were beep, beep?
Yeah, like
Nextel or something? Yeah, those were cool, actually.
Yeah.
So.
Okay, cool. So we're going to go into the first segment, sponsored by Arm of Sport. And that's, what would we call it, like the current, what's going on with Jeremy now. So Arm of Sport. Endurance and action sports require peak performance from athletes' bodies and the proper nutrition before, during, and after these activities. Arma recognized a void in the marketplace and created a complete line of nutritional supplements formulated specifically to help athletes and enthusiasts of all levels realize their maximum potential. They utilize not only the best ingredient combinations, but clinically proven dosages. Arma nutritional supplements have undoubtedly achieved best-in-class formulations. Visit armasport.com for more. So that gym downstairs, are you pounding Arma and working out there much? Like, I mean, you have a gym that puts like LA Fitness to shame down there.
Well, you know what? It used to be all up here. So it used to be a lot bigger when I was like lifting and having to do all that. Now it's more like cardio machines because, you know, I just got to watch the old man figure.
Yeah.
So I recently got like a cold pool. Because that's kind of the new thing,
They go from the sauna.
So we go sauna, cold pool, sauna, cold pool, and then jacuzzi.
Yeah.
Man, it's a trip, dude. When you go from the sauna to the cold pool, your eyes start getting all weird. Like, it gets all euphoric. It's really crazy. So, really, we have dumbbells and we have mostly cardio. Kim has some stuff in there, reformer and stuff for Pilates, but.
Yeah, do the girls work out down there?
They do. I get them over there sometimes.
Yeah.
Not as much as they should, but yeah, I'm trying to get them into it.
What is the benefit of that cold heat thing?
Supposedly, with the ice bath, it turns your brown fat cells into white, and they burn.
Oh, really?
So it gets your metabolism going. So it makes it sort of supposed to burns the bad stuff out of your body, really.
Oh, okay.
Gets it into action. But I'm not big on that.
The ice?
I'm not big on the all, you know, exactly what it does.
Yeah.
I'm definitely pounding Arma when I'm down there because I'm sweating a lot, so that's good.
Yeah. Hey, the Arma protein, right? The chocolate, I think, has a pretty distinct flavor.
Mm-hmm.
Is that the turmeric in there? And turmeric is supposed to be good for inflammation in your joints or something.
Yeah, turmeric is definitely good for joints. It's inflammation type thing, and it's hard to say, you know, like that you're mixing chocolate just with water, then, right?
Yeah,
water. Yeah, I put them in smoothies all the time, so it's kind of hard to tell. I don't notice as much as you might.
Yeah.
But and then if I'm drinking I'm a more of a vanilla guy with when it comes to protein, so I don't taste it much.
Yeah. I like that you guys came out with the it's something new, right? The individual
stick
fire
packs.
And
yeah, we have single serves now for all of our products, which is Blitz and our Hydrate, which is the two flavors, watermelon and lemon lime, and then we got Blitz, which is the Berry Blast, and then our protein, of course. So yeah, it's awesome, man. You can just take them with you on the road. I went riding the other day at Cahia, and I had a bunch of Arma, and we brought like a cooler, and just like anyone wanted to come by, I grabbed gave a stick pack, and these old dudes were sitting next to me and just riding. And I'm like, he's like, hey man, you want a cactus cooler?
cactus coolers
are so good, but I'm like, no, maybe you should try like an Arma stick.
Yeah.
And he's like, what would this do to me? I go, oh, it's hydrate, man. It'll hydrate you. Uh-huh. All right, man. Yeah, I'm going to try that.
A cactus cooler.
So it was pretty funny. These old guys that are there on Wednesdays with their two strokes and stuff, just so cool talking to them, you know?
There's an old dude that used to be at Milestone all the time, and he would always be eating Ding Dongs and that Starbucks mocha chino or whatever.
Oh, man.
He was always like offering me Ding Dongs and stuff.
But they were super nice, but I hooked him up with some Arma.
Nice. Hey, the watermelon especially is good. Like, I like it when I mountain bike.
Yeah,
I love it. Because it still tastes good when it's not cold.
Yeah.
Like, is that something you guys think about formulating stuff?
Our formulation lately has, we had a lot of black pepper extract in our hydrate, which when it got a little warm, you could taste a little peppery to it. Mm-hmm. So we've since backed that down a little bit. Now you shouldn't notice as much. But what I like is the watermelon hydrate with some strawberry lemonade fire. Like
a
combo.
Oh,
I'm mixing.
Like bartending, like
so good.
Tom Cruise
a scoop of fire, and a scoop of watermelon hydrate or a stick pack, and you know, your full water bottle. Man, it's just so good.
Yeah, but I mean, do you guys ever take into consideration that it might not be consumed cold, like on a cycling?
Yeah, for sure. And that was part of the reason we changed the formula a little bit, just on the black pepper part of it, because it was. Fairly strong, even though it's really good, and that is what carries the hydration to your cells.
Oh, okay.
So having a lot of it is fine, but you could taste it.
Yeah.
You could taste the black pepper, and it was spicy a little bit. So,
yeah.
And the warmer it got, the more you could taste it.
Yeah.
So, yeah, trust me, we know. We ride road bikes and mountain bikes and all that stuff all the time, and when it gets warm. But now we're good to go on all of it. So,
yeah,
it's good.
Okay, so on your Instagram, I saw you're at Cahuilla. Wednesday.
Yeah.
Actually, I called you and you were like, I'm going to Cahuilla. You going to ride? And I'm like, oh, I'm hurt.
You told me about that.
But Cahuilla's close for you. It's closer than going to Paris or something else for you.
Yeah, it's about the same.
Is it?
Yeah. I mean, Elsinore, they're all about an hour. What, hour and 15 minutes? I mean, Paul is 40 minutes. Mm-hmm. So, or Fox Raceway, I should say, I guess. But, Cahuilla's my favorite, man. It's tracks up and down the hills. The dirt's super good. Yeah, it was fun. We had a good time. There's a bunch of cool guys there and had a good day riding.
They changed the layout recently.
Yeah, it's going backwards. Or
backwards.
The other direction, I would say. Not
so
backwards.
The finish line jump, you're jumping downhill again?
Downhill. Yeah, okay. Super cool.
Yeah. I used to like going there on Wednesdays because Dean Wilson's dad was always there.
Riding?
Yeah, he'd be there riding. He'd be on an old CR252 stroke. And he would literally bring a lunch bag. And he had all these other old guys that would meet every Wednesday, and they would just sit there and talk crap.
That's cool. He probably still does. I didn't see him, but you know who was there? Cameron Steele was there. Johnny Campbell was there. Scott Harden was there. They were all riding off-road loop out there.
Mm-hmm.
And then there was like, I don't know, Axel was there. Bierman was there.
Mm-hmm. Scrub Daddy was there. Did he talk to you?
No, I saw him, but he was filming.
Oh.
I saw him filming. Yeah. You know what's funny? First lap I went out riding, Bierman comes along, hops in right behind me. I don't even know where I'm going on the track. There's a couple big fun doubles. And I think Scrub Daddy was right there. And the very first lap, Bierman's from behind, and then I don't jump the jump, and he just jumps, whips it over my head on lap one.
And Scrub Daddy puts it on his Instagram.
I'm like, dude, really? You're going to blow me out like that on lap one?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was pretty funny. He probably didn't recognize that happened, but I was like, dang, man, he just got a sick shot of him jumping over my head, like looking like I'm not jumping the jumps.
Oh. So. Okay, so what are you riding these days? Are you on an SR yet? special 450?
I have an SR.
You do?
Which is awesome. But I have it set up for Supercross, for Science of Supercross during Supercross season.
Yeah.
So I don't actually have it to be riding outdoor yet. So I'm riding my regular KX 450 outdoor with A-Kit suspension. So it's the same thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But dude, that SR. Did you play a role in the testing and the R&D of the SR at all?
No.
Dude, when we had the bike intro test that day, I mean, I fired it up, you know, at the trailer. And just starting it and the way it snapped, I was like, oh.
Yeah, it's got some head work, I think, to it.
Yeah.
It's a fun bike. I rode it at Supercross not too long ago. And, man, it was, for me, it was awesome. It felt like a real race bike. It was cool.
Yeah. I think, well, we're going to do like a factory edition shootout here pretty soon. We have the KTM. And obviously, the Husky's coming pretty soon. And the Honda, I picked up 2 days ago at Honda.
Oh, that's cool.
And so, yeah, we're going to do that. Should be interesting. But I see the green coming up on top. The thing was awesome.
It's a good bike, man. It's funny. It's so much different, so much more bottom and mid than the standard one. And it's hard to do, right? I mean, 450s rip, even stock.
Yeah. So what do you think about the way EF5 feels compared to the carbureted four-stroke? Because I think, didn't you test a CR450 with EF5 before it ever came out?
No, but there was some tricks that they were doing to the carburetor that they got figured out on the CR back in the day that really, you know, when the first four strokes first came, they were kind of still had that little bit of sketchy, like hesitation or, you know, I wouldn't call it a bog, but just kind of like a weird four stroke feel. And then I think they were the first ones kind of to figure out the carburetor side of it.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it felt like EFI back then, you know, but I think it's good. I mean, you don't have to worry about trusting it anymore.
Yeah.
So.
I just remember all the four-stroke temperament, like the
there was some growing pains
and the hot start.
Yeah, there was some growing pains for sure with those things, man. They were, gosh, if you stalled them, it was like, yeah, crazy.
Yeah. When you're on Honda, you had the option to race a four-stroke, but I remember you were on a CR250 still for a little while, right?
Yeah, I mean, I was only racing for fun.
Yeah.
That was like 05 or something.
Why did you lean for the two stroke?
I mean, that's what I raced my whole life. So it just made more sense. But I mean, you know, it was comedy because, you know, I raced the first couple races. That was that year I crashed. The year that was muddy, I think, at Anaheim, I raced two stroke, crash maybe. Next week was Phoenix. I raced two stroke. It was like the last hole shot by a two-stroke. They had a split start. Mm-hmm. Came out in the first in the lead on the main event and did a knack-knack on the first lap, which was pretty funny. Stupid, but funny. I knew I didn't have a shot at winning, so I was like, oh, I better do something fun.
Something for the crowd.
Yeah. Ended up getting fourth, though.
Mm-hmm.
It was pretty cool. And then the next week, I raced the 450 in San Diego and got fourth. So, I don't know. It was cool.
Yeah.
I was still brand new to the 450. You know, there was a lot of guys riding them a lot at that point.
Yeah.
So, that was cool.
All right. So, once again, I put out a call on my Instagram for some fan questions.
I did see that.
So, the fan question is brought to us by our friends at Max's Tires. From your bike to your truck and almost everything in between with wheels, Max's will have you hooking up, pulling the hole shot, and beating your competition. One of the world's most trusted tire brands, Maxxis delivers high-quality tire products that perform no matter what the terrain or conditions. If you don't believe me, just ask the king, Jeremy McGrath. Visit Maxxis.com for more. So, yeah, I asked you last week, and you said,
absolutely. You can count on Maxxis. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay, so this question, I chose it because it was kind of like, I want to know, too. So it's from Guto Bernardes, and I think he's in Brazil. But he says, hey, Don, ask the king how he ate shit doing a knack-knack in Brazil in the late 90s during a demo. The rumor at that time was that the grip fell off during the trick. It's so cool what you guys are doing. Keep up the good job. Do you remember something like that?
No, of course I remember. That's the only time I've ever crashed doing a knack-knack,
really?
Honestly. And I mean, it knocked me out, dude. I was like, I was doing a demo. We were at some Brazilian thing and there was a freestyle jump or whatever. And it was just more like but it was kind of rainy.
Uh-huh.
It was kind of misty, you know, it was like wet and the bike was a little wet. And if you've ever seen me do knack-knacks where I don't, like I'll start to do it and then I don't do it, you know, I like back out of it, like,
yeah.
And it's kind of a, it looks weird, like dead sailor type thing. Well, that's kind of what I did there.
Mm-hmm.
I whipped it like this and I went to put my leg over and I was like, nah, don't feel right. And it was wet, so my leg slipped off anyway.
Slipped off foot peg.
So no, or, the right leg slipped over.
Oh, okay.
So then I'm like on my left peg with my left foot and I'm landing like this. And you know, your right hand, I mean, when you land like this, you're just
whiskey.
It's gonna wide open, right? So I just like landed wide open on the left peg, fully just fully ate it and it knocked me out. Like I was out.
No.
Yeah. And I'm not sure if the grip came off. I don't remember the grip coming off while I was doing the trick. You know what I mean?
Maybe when the bike.
Maybe when I ate it, the grip came off. But yeah, that was embarrassing, man. That was so embarrassing. We had so much fun in Brazil and it was, you know, everything was shaping up good. It was so cool.
Was it a race or were you there?
No, it was they were having a race, but I was just doing an exhibition.
Oh, okay.
With a couple guys like Pocoroba and, you know, okay, a couple dudes were there. It was a Brazilian race or something, national championship or something.
Wow.
Yeah, so.
Were you on your bike or was it like a?
It was the same bike. I was on a YZ250, but it was the same bike I had ridden all week. Uh-huh. We were filming for Still Roots.
Okay.
Oh, I remember. So we were at the beach and we were all over the place and just having a blast. I mean, Brazil is amazing. I love Brazil. But that crash was just, yeah. It didn't slow us down though. We went out that night, had some beers. It wasn't that bad of a concussion, but it was a concussion.
Yeah. What was Brazil like? I mean, I had an opportunity to go one time.
Yeah.
It was when my kids were young and like literally the night before the Designations trip was starting. I'm not going.
Oh, you were going to go to the Designations one?
Yeah.
Yeah. I heard there was a lot of like snakes and crazy spiders and stuff where those guys were all staying for that.
Yeah, I didn't miss
it. Yeah. My experience from Brazil is amazing. I have these friends there named Cacau and this Andre and Paulo from Three Brothers.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we hung out with Edinho, which is Pele's, you know, son.
Mm-hmm.
And we just had a great crew. And we talk on Instagram now still and just talking about moto and all that stuff. But we had a great crew. We traveled all around. We went out to like this rave area where the kids go to spring break. We took the motos out on the out on these little ponga boats,
uh-huh.
And we stayed out in this like all inclusive like rave resort with our bikes and rode. You saw Still Roots where I like the helicopter followed me and I endoed and ate it. That was on like a sand thing in the middle of a river.
Uh-huh.
It was rad. I mean, just the experience of being there, it was super cool. Wakeboarded behind a helicopter,
mm-hmm.
Off a helicopter skid.
Yeah, I remember. So wait, was there footage of the knack-knack crash that didn't make Steel Roots?
I think there is footage, but I think we were done kind of, I don't know, I think we were wrapping up filming, so I'm not sure.
Yeah.
There's some, I think if you found it, you probably find it on YouTube, actually, because there's some like home video of it somewhere.
Uh-huh.
Yeah,
oh, man. Dude, the Steel Roots era was awesome. I just, it was like, you know, because like all the video trends and everything, it would be like the style of videos was all chapters, right, with different riders and everything. But a video that was all McGrath was just so sick.
You know, it's so different from now, right? I mean, like people just don't have the patience to watch a 30-minute video anymore.
Mm.
If your video is longer than 2 or 3 minutes, you're like, everyone's gone.
Yeah.
So it would be pretty cool to kind of remake it, do another some little fun thing with a bunch of old dudes. It'd mm-hmm. be kind of fun.
The crazy thing is that the music you got for those videos was so good. And it was like, I think it was before licensing was
no,
so expensive.
No, it wasn't before.
No.
Before it was expensive maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah, we had some connections in the music world to get some stuff. But we had Megadeth.
Yeah.
We had like Social D. And of course, we had a lot of the, you know, the punk bands and back then and stuff. So We had a lot of cool music. It was fun. Yeah, popular stuff.
Hey, that there was a scene in you're driving the Toyota T100 through, it was like a desert area, and I think a tire fell out at the end. Was that planned?
No, that wasn't planned.
Oh, really?
No, that wasn't planned. That was me and Chamberlain. Uh-huh. We were driving out. I think where we were riding that day was kind of out by Dumont Dunes. Mm-hmm. There's a place we found out there that's like kind of like Ocotillo. That's still like one of the sickest places I've ever seen.
Yeah.
And we were just kind of driving in, and yeah, my.
It was like, you know, perfect.
When you bounce the truck, we had an extra tire or something.
Yeah.
And it just flew out. Yeah. Pretty funny.
That's awesome. Okay, so we're going to go to our next segment, which is my favorite, the Bell helmets back in the day. Okay, through the magic of video and editing, we're now in the hallway for the Bell back in the day segment. So if you're listening to this on Spotify or Stitcher or some sort of podcast server, you might want to go to YouTube and watch it, because this is an extremely visual segment of the show. So we're here right now with the 125 era, so the first 125 number Pro Circuit peak Honda, as well as your Team Green Kawasaki KX125. And I remember this one, because that was your first Supercross win, was this year, and it was like, oh, that was when the local hero buddy of mine went and won Supercross. Was it Vegas you won?
Yeah, it was Vegas. So it's a funny story, because 1990, I barely lost the championship that year to Ty Davis, and I was still riding Loretta Lynn's and Ponca City and stuff. So back then you could ride the amateur races and then still ride Supercross and not have to be like full pro, you know, I mean, you could still be the A class or whatever. So anyways, yeah, this is the 90 bike from the Vegas race. Some shots here of, there's 90 World Mini right there. And so this year, the night I won in 90 at Vegas was the night Chicken won too. Mm-hmm. So Cowie won 1-1 that night.
Yeah.
And in fact, I think that was Chicken's only main event win, right?
Yeah.
I think it was. He's only won one big bike main event.
Yeah.
He was too busy taking Bradshaw out, the rest of them.
Yeah.
Or messing with everybody else. One of my favorites, but he was always distracted.
Brushing his mullet.
Yeah, something. Working on the chicks working on that stuff. And then we went from this bike, of course, to the very first ever Team Pro Circuit, Team Peak Honda bike, like Honda Team. I remember, and we've talked about this story.
Yeah, in the last show you said you were supposed to be on Team Honda.
Yeah, that's what we've talked about. So it was, it's such a funny subject to talk about now, right? Because back then I was like, yes, factory Honda, and then wait, nope, you're going down to Pro Circuit Honda Team. And so it was always one of those things where you're like, whoa, knowing what we know now, right, it was the shit. It was the best team to be on. And, you know, factory Honda supported, you know, Mitch's great company at Pro Circuit, and we had Bones, and, you know, the 91 model bike had like A-kit suspension is what they call it now. So we had factory suspension.
Yeah.
After 91, we had to go, 92 had to be a production rule. Mm-hmm. Right, so our forks and stuff were basically what you could buy at the dealer and all that stuff. So, but yeah, this was like, this is kind of the gear. This is Axo, right?
Yeah.
So you can't hardly see it right here, but maybe we can move this. Anyway, we had Bell as our sponsor, obviously. Yeah. Bevo and Scott Goggles back in the day, right? And then, Axo gear was Jim Hale making all our stuff, and it was pretty much had the setup. It was either Axo or Fox, right, back then, and we had Axo, so we were styling.
You know what I see on this helmet? It's like, oh, that's an aftermarket Troy Lee visor, right?
Yeah.
Troy sold thousands of those visors,
oh,
right?
Oh, millions,
like,
probably,
it's funny you think now, like, no one ever changes their visor to aftermarket visor, but back then, that was the shit, because the visor that came on that Bell, it had those weird slits, right?
Yeah, and it was down. There was no, like, you looked total goon back then. Yeah.
But that was,
that's what artists do, right? Troy's such an artist. He's a helmet painter, and he's the baddest painter there is, right? But he's such an artist, so he looks at stuff differently than we do. Yeah. And when, I mean, this thing was so popular, Troy's visors and his paint and his stuff, but Troy's visors, mm-hmm. remember when he made the visor that was just a visor?
Yeah, yeah.
It just was like a hard plastic sort of visor that you wear all the time.
Yeah.
Larry Ward used to rock them with Sheen.
It was like a mullet accessory.
Yeah, right? It was like
balanced out the back.
Oh, it was definitely, yeah. It was awesome. It was so awesome back then. So, too funny. He also made those hats where, you know, the troll doll that you spin like that and the hair goes up. He made those crazy hats with that. I mean, Troy's had some funny, funny ideas along the way.
I remember that hat, the funny hair hat. My brother Ross would wear it and he looked normal.
Oh, right, right.
Because his hair looked like that.
Was like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's so funny. So, yeah, we had AXO. And I ran AXO for a couple of years, right? Because we were 91 and 92. And then after that, it was always interesting. And I never thought about it much. But, you know, Bob Rathkamp, who was Cinesalo, importer back in the day, right? Mm-hmm. So he was Cinesalo. And Jim Hale was AXO. And when I left, there was a great podcast that Jim Hale did. And it talked about me and my transition from 125 to 250. Mm-hmm. And I was AXO and I went to Cinesalo, and I always wondered, like, oh man, you know, how did that really transpire? You would have think that AXO wanted to keep me, right? But if you remember then, he had Stan and Bradshaw.
Yeah.
And so he's like, well, do we really need another Honda factory rider? And this kid's kind of young and blah, blah. And it was always funny because in the podcast, he just laughs. He goes, boy, that was a massive mistake. But, you know, to go from AXO then to Cinesalo, which Cinesalo really at the time, Wardy was the main rider. Mm-hmm. And they had a lot of riders in Europe. But Cinesalo at the time really wasn't that hip.
Yeah.
So, you know, cool. Cheers to Bob Rathkamp and what was his name? Kenny, I think, was the designer, right?
Kenny Safford.
Kenny Safford.
Yeah.
And so Kenny Safford.
See, I think Kenny did stuff for AXO as well.
He did.
Yeah.
He did. And I think Cinesalo and AXO were in the same building for a while. Bob was at
there in Valencia.
Yeah, so Bob was in Jim's building.
Because I remember Cinesalo riders used to wear AXO boots.
They did.
That was kind of
exactly.
Like the thing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So anyway, the good old days, pretty fun, you know?
So when you look at this.
I don't know if you guys can see these gloves, but I mean.
All the thermal weld plastic. Dude.
I mean, let's see if we can get one of these off the mannequin.
Hey, that jersey, looking at it, I remember when the AXO jerseys came out and they had that turtleneck.
Oh, terry cloth.
Terry cloth, turtleneck looking thing. But those jerseys were so hot.
Oh, man. Yeah, look at that thing.
And they were just cotton, right? So they stained. You got splashed in the mud and that jersey was done.
And you were dying of heat exhaustion.
Yeah.
Wearing those things. But they were good for Supercross because Supercross was always cold.
Cold, yeah.
Yeah. So lots of padding back in the day, which is entirely different from today.
Yeah, everybody wears minimalist.
It's so weird how the change has happened, you know?
Mm-hmm.
When I was young and I was an amateur, I wore Fox paw protectors.
Paw protectors.
And they had all the hard plastic on them. And then AXO had the same thing. They had hard plastic on theirs. And so this was kind of like the newest version, but it still had a pretty big pad on it, you know? I mean, if you got hit with a rock, you were thankful you had it, but not too bad for an old glove, 91 series. Anyway.
You know what's funny about these bikes too is like the width of that front fender on this KX125.
Yeah.
Like, so big. And then look how big the numbers are too, right?
The squad, yeah, these are my buddy Eddie J's numbers.
Okay. Yeah, and you talked about that.
Yeah, we talked about the last one. And
the reflective.
When we went to that bike with this font, we took the reflective font he saw your podcast, our podcast, the other day, and he's like, dude, I got to get you some numbers for those bikes. So we're going to revisit the old Eddie J. Hit the font, sick.
Yeah.
We were, like, I was stoked that Mitch let me use it because I think, Lamson was my teammate, and he just used the standard, like, he was 29, I think.
Yeah.
Right, so, but anyways, always looking for something to be styly with, you know?
Yeah. So looking at that Honda, I remember when the team came out, we're like, blue tanks? How'd they get a blue tank? Troy would paint those, right?
Troy painted the tanks, and they were not aluminum, so they were plastic, so he had to figure out a way to paint the tank and make them stick.
Would the paint come off eventually?
Yeah, we would only run them for one or two weekends. Probably. Supercross, I mean, depending on what happened, you know, when you wear the old school knee braces and stuff, you'd rub the paint right off, you know. But yeah, I can imagine, you know, like Skip back in the day being a mechanic, which he came from Team Green and went with me over Honda. Just building this bike was a pain, right? Because, I mean, Hondas were red.
Yeah.
So I'm still even funny that Honda even let bike happen. Right? Let it happen. But at the time, Yamaha was not blue.
Yamahas were white.
Yeah, Yamahas were white and purple or something. Yeah.
So how was it going from this? Because this was a Pro Circuit KX125 too, right?
Not really. Well, you know the story about that, right? So when I was riding Hondas, privateer Hondas in 89 or 88, before I got a Team Green ride, I was riding for Raceway Honda out of Paris. And I would just go there after high school and work and, you know, do the fish, parts counter and all that stuff, and, you know, service batteries and stuff in the back, whatever. With my my buddy Fast Bob, who was like the head mechanic back in the day. He was so rad. Just such a rad crew over there. And I was just a little kid trying to learn. Fast Bob was like, he knew moto, you know? And I was like the new kid. I don't talk about it or whatever, but anyway, I went to Mitch one day, and this is the story I've talked about in my book, that I was like, you know, Mitch, hey, I need some help in my suspension. You know, those 89 CRs were like death machines. Those things are gnarly. Twitchy, and I was a little kid trying to ride 250 and 125, and that was kind of the famous story when I quit Pro Circuit, right? Because I went into Pro Circuit, and I was like, you know, Mitch, I need, my dad made me go by myself. I barely had my driver's license, and I was like, I need some help. I'm not getting enough, you know, personal attention. I'm really having trouble, and that's when he kind of. And he gave me the like, who do you think you are, Rick Johnson, and all this stuff. And I'm like, no, I don't. I don't think I'm anybody, but I do know that I'm tank slapping all over the track and I'm going to kill myself. And if we're talking about sponsor stuff here, I need some help. Yeah. And so anyways, he's all, if you leave Pro Circuit, you'll never be on Pro Circuit again. And so that was the story on that. And I left Pro Circuit just bawling. I was crying. I came home to my dad. I'm like, I quit, but I stuck to my guns. And that's when I got sponsored by White Brothers.
Okay.
And so there was a big guy named Bill, big giant guy that did suspension for White Brothers. And he helped me out a lot. He really helped me out a lot. And so we ran like a FMF pipe, I think, back then with a, it was a Bill's pipe. It was a Bill Keefe pipe. And then I don't know exactly who did the engine. I'm not sure, but anyways, it was kind of a hodgepodge setup, really. Which didn't really matter, right? Because 6 months later, I was back on back on Pro Circuit, and you know, at the end of the day, Mitch had a lot of respect for me, I think, for doing that. And we still get along great. We laugh and talk and just talk crap to each other, and it's such a, you know, great relationship. But it was a really high tense moment for a little kid like me back then. And having to quit a team like that when Ricky Johnson, my hero, and all these other heroes of ours were Pro Circuit riders, you know? So it was it was a strange time. But so back to your original question, this was not a Pro Circuit bike.
Okay.
But when I went from this to that, it was like someone gave me 20 more horsepower. I mean, if you remember Supercross back then, this year, some triples were too big to jump on 125s. And if you did jump them, you had to bang third right off the takeoff to get like the extra 5 feet of like pull, if you could get it. And a lot of guys, you know, when we went to that, we were jumping every triple in second gear. Like it was a pretty major advantage, you know, especially when the dirt got really soft and ruddy, right? Because you kind of had to like feel it out and then rear hat at the last second. And, you know, our bikes, the Honda bikes, were always so fast, you know. So, clear advantage, for sure. Yeah.
That's awesome. So, that was a super cool trip down memory lane or memory hall right there. Again, the Back in the Day segment was brought to us by Bell Helmets, which was established in 1954. They're the makers of the Moto 10 Spherical. And the choice of professionals like Eli Tomac, Cooper Webb, Jeremy McGrath, of course, Dylan Ferrandis, and Pro Circuit Racing. The Bell Moto 10 Spherical is the official helmet of the Life on Two Wheels vlog, and sadly, I've personally put many of them to the test already. Visit bellhelmets.com for more. So that hallway down there is just amazing. It's like most moto fans, or all moto fans, and especially those in the 30 to 50 year old range, would just bust a nut walking in there, looking at all that stuff in person, right? It's pretty cool that you have all this stuff still, and that you've saved gear from every year. And I think you told me once you've never given a helmet away.
If I've given a helmet away, it's to someone like Rossi, where we do a helmet swap. Mm-hmm. But really, I keep my helmets. Those are like my art, you know? So it's a trait that I never thought I'd have. You know, my dad used to keep everything and kind of just, you know, he's kind of like a hoarder on stuff. I feel like he just keeps a lot of stuff. And I always, when I was always a kid, I was like, oh man, my dad always had stuff around the garage. And I was like, man, I'm never going to be that way. And then here I am, and I'm so thankful for it, to be honest, because I have a lot of my collection of all my stuff. And
I mean, even your amateur helmet back then.
Yeah, I mean, frankly, we're just cracking the ice here. There's a lot in that hallway, but there's a lot upstairs here. So when we run out of stuff to talk about in the hallway,
go in the attic.
Then we're just going to start getting everything out of the attic. So we got a lot to show you guys. You guys will be excited.
So the keeping the helmets, though, is that because there is that white. Geez, is that even a Moto 4 up there?
It is a Moto. It's a Moto. Yeah, I think it's a Moto 4.
Yeah.
Metal screen in the front.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But I noticed when we were standing there, there's a Bad Boy of Bad Boy Club painted on the top of that helmet. Were you sponsored by them?
I was not. I didn't even know Ricky Johnson at the time. I mean, that was 87. I didn't know anyone.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I had racing at Paris, but I mean, I knew Mike Chamberlain and Derek Natvig. Those were my buddies.
Yeah.
You know? And we were just racing for YZ bucks. But the funny thing is that helmet, you know, I wore Bell because my dad wore Bell.
Mm-hmm.
But Bell was an established, safe brand.
Yeah.
And so my dad was like, look, they were already scared enough that I was riding dirt bikes, right? So, you know, that's why I started late, because they were nervous of that, and I was riding BMX up to that point. But especially if I was going to race dirt bikes, I needed to wear some established brands that were to keep me safe. Fortunately, I didn't crash all that much, which is good, but the few times I did, that Bell protect my head. The other funny thing about that helmet is my dad's friend Steve is a sign painter. He's the one that painted that on there.
Oh, okay.
Now, it's a Johnny O kind of replica paint.
Yeah.
But it has the Ricky Johnson Bad Boy on the top.
Uh-huh.
So you can tell I was like a fan of both of those guys.
Uh-huh.
Johnny was always super clean and you know, he's a badass too, but Ricky was just kind of like, you know, he had the Bad Boy thing going. And later on, you know, by the time I got good enough to be sponsored by someone like, you know, it was Life's a Beach back then.
Yeah.
And then Bad Boy, and then it went to No Fear. So, of course, I was a No Fear guy. And I was a Life's a Beach guy. Just right at the end of it. Not much.
You know, the funny thing about that Bad Boy cartoon is, remember Kenny Watson?
Mm-hmm.
Kenny Watson had he had this tattoo of like this black circle saw blade on his arm. And I was like, dude, what is that funky tattoo? He goes, dude.
He told you it was a Bad Boy underneath it?
He goes, I got a Bad Boy tattoo because I was the biggest RJ fan. He goes, I went to a dealership signing and I was like, RJ, check it out. He showed him the tattoo, and Ricky looked at him like he was crazy for tattooing that on him. So he's like, screw that guy. He covered it up.
Oh, really? I've seen some guys that have my name on them and stuff. It's weird. It is
strange. Or portraits of you, right? Riding?
Portraits, riding, and my signature. They'll like, have you they'll have a portrait it? And they'll sign, and then they'll get the name tattooed. It's weird.
That's still cool.
It's cool. It's flattering. You know what? It's flattering. It's a little strange. I would never do that, but it's certainly flattering, man. I mean, that means you know, I was made an impact on somebody, and that was cool, man.
Yeah.
Stoked.
Right on. Well, hey guys, thanks for checking out this episode of the King and I podcast presented by Monster Energy. We'll see you in a couple weeks for more.